word before I start to sort of set up what the talk is that I've been attending a great series of conferences in Portugal and Porto called Keep It Simple, Make It Faster. Some of you know about it, I'm sure, and some of you have been to it. In fact, curated by Paulo Guerra and Andy Bennett. And that's been making me think about tempo, because there's a lot of kind of papers at those conferences about speedcore, thrash, hardcore, the importance of speed. And in fact, I edited a paper about the Ramones and response to kind of like speed, and the Ramones response to kind of the arrival of hardcore punk rock in sort of 79-ish, you know, what happened to them sonically, and also kind of like social incomes, really. But what happens if you look at the slow stuff? Actually, it turned out that there wasn't that much that I could find about slow tempos in kind of like contemporary kind of rock and indie. It's out there, but there's not much of it. It's scattered all over the place. I'll come back to that in a moment. And I just want to start with this from Thought Code, is top 2017 top 10 slowcore albums. Just to sort of like give you kind of like a few terms that are used in discourse around slowcore, and then I'll talk a little bit more about what that is. And the importance of kind of like speed, or the notions of speed and tempo in the primarily, but I'll talk about a couple of other genres in passing. The listing has Lobo's pioneering album at number 4, which is weird, because given that they're described as kind of like the godparents of slowcore, they should kind of be at number 1. But Lobo's slowcore's patron saints of long reveled in an angelic song world of heavenly harmonies and holier than thou of airs, the married Mormon pair of Mimi Parker and Alan Sparhawk, playing their strikingly Spartan, powerfully quiet music, powerfully quiet. Let's bear some of these minds, some of these kind of terms in mind, sorry. With the kind of reverence usually reserved for devotionals, admittedly they've grown both grumpier and funnier. I've certainly got grumpier, I'm not sure about funnier, over the years. Testing the boundaries of the low sound with blasts of distortion and straight up pop, amongst other experiments. Okay. Their debut captured them at a time in which their defiantly anti-rock stance was at its most astonishingly pure. I Could Live in Hope is a set of really slow, really quiet, really sad, really, really beautiful songs laid out naked in the face of grunge. And that's got pretty much elements of everything I want to say something about in the next 15 or so minutes. Just before I move on to the presentation proper, the point about really quiet, I find absolutely fascinating. I saw Lobo about 10 years back, and it was really loud. It was a quite astonishing loud performance. I used earplugs because of my tinnitus. I had to actually take my ear defenders out of my little rucksack in the Glasgow show at the... even with ear defenders on, I had to retreat to the back of the hall because the bass notes were just like really body vibratingly loud. So the notion of them being really quiet is interesting, because you have to think about what quiet means in terms of kind of like song performance as well. Okay. So this is Lobo from Duluth, Minnesota. A typical image of kind of from that slowcore era. This is towards the end of the 90s, but they formed in 1993. Arrived with a snowy landscape. Me, far up in the middle. There was a selection of bass players that kind of like came and went over the years. Okay, so. A brief read and then I'll get into some of the presentation. In the splintering of subgenres that accompanied indie music's transition from the 80s to the 90s, a group of bands emerged that played, quote, impressively slowly, from Fox in 2009, talking about sub-pop band coding. These groups were perhaps lazily grouped together as a new genre, slowcore. These artists were not the first to use slow tempos to explore the harmonic power of particular rock sounds and melody, but these bands, none of whom were particularly fond of the label slowcore, were at least in part reaction to the aggression and speed of the grunge movement that's present in that kind of like retroactive review of the Lobo album. One of the most important of these bands for me, and I guess for other people as well, in their approach to tempo was Lobo, and what they did was, and I think this is kind of particularly striking example of this, was they did a cover of Joy Division's Transmission. I'll play pick up with those in a second. But first of all, some questions. What do you mean by speed in popular music? Yes, it's BPMs, but there are other ways of thinking about what speed is. How do we perceive speed? A little bit of that very helpful, I think, in the previous kind of presentation, where you've got things like quarter notes, 16th notes. If you're playing with 16th notes, I'm not a musicologist, but I'm an old punk rocker, so I know a little bit about this. If you've got 16th notes in a bar, it's going to sound faster, even if the BPMs are kind of like actually technically slower. So there's things that we've got to think about in terms of how speed is perceived. What are the relationships between genre or style and speed? I'm going to answer some of these questions and some maybe not. We'll see how we get on. How do other textual characteristics work with speed or tempo to signify generic coherence, in this case in the genre of slowcore? I don't want to say too much about that, but reverberation and reverb effects is incredibly important. They're kind of like slow tempo music or low tempo music. Contextually, to whom does speed matter, why, and in what ways? And this is at the beginning of something I want to say, I want to investigate in much more detail. This is really the beginning of the thing I want to spend a lot more time on, so I think it's really important. Okay, so the start point of this research is a little bit of background on Logan. Formed in 1993, as I said, in Duluth, Minnesota, featuring Minnie Parker on drums and vocals and Alan Sparhawk on guitar and vocals. They are the two key players who've been around for a long time. Very often, in any discussion of the band, there's always some reference to the fact that they're Mormons and they're married. So, and that somehow kind of informs our understanding of the slowness and the quote devotional nature of their music. In a much later interview, Sparhawk claimed in 2007 that the notion of slowcore, the idea, the term slowcore, was coined by a record store acquaintance in Duluth in 1993 as a joke, and it kind of stuck. Whether that's true or not, I don't know. My colleague here, Kyle, who's here, is a brilliant archive researcher, and I might draw on his expertise to try and like find where slowcore came from. Because I think your methodologies are excellent in that respect. Low and other slowcore bands were, however, unhappy with the term in the 1990s. That's not unusual. Bands don't like being part of a kind of like a standardized kind of generic category for the most part. So. Okay, this song you may be familiar with. Joy Division's transmission from 1979, this is a standard 7-inch mix of that. And in 1996, as part of a project of cover versions of Joy Division songs, Lou recorded and released this. However, it's not always obvious. as I mentioned at the top of the presentation, quarter notes or 16th notes, particularly 16th notes, can make a song feel fast, but the actual BPMs are relatively low. Then there's the speed of playing and the notion of virtuosity, which goes back to kind of like classical canon performances of, you know, like, particularly in the world of violin playing, but clearly in the world of lead guitar playing, where speed of the number of notes you can squeeze into it when you give it bar, really incredibly important. Look at Steve Vai. Genre and speed. When I was thinking about this in terms of slowness of indie or alternative music, someone said to me, you know what, there's lots of other stuff that does slow. There's like very slow forms of metal. I saw a spectacularly good, whose name I can't remember, Irish sludge metal band in Glasgow a couple of years back, and I actually couldn't believe how slow they were playing. It's a very, some of you may know, it's really hard to play really slow. So these, but there are kind of like huge kind of like variations, so like doing slow and then through that thrash and speed. In pop, you've got kind of romantic tragic ballads, which are tend to be slow BPMs, or beat free sometimes, but then you've got up-tempo, dancey kind of pop, kind of from the, really from the 1920s, 1930s onwards. Jazz, you've got kind of like slow, smooth, mellow jazz, but you've also got bebop, which kind of like shot with its arrival in the 1940s, largely to do with its speed, with its BPM, because people were playing fast. And of course, electronic dance music, we have entire subgenres entirely defined by their BPMs. Gabber from the Netherlands as a kind of a subgenre of techno, and BPMs up to around about 180, people are probably better at BPM scholarship than I am, but that's incredibly fast. It's hard to dance to, but that's kind of the point. Okay. Other textual characteristics that go along with speed, particularly the genre of slowcore, the notion of sad and downbeat lyrics in slowcore. There's another genre which I kind of thought was sort of like a joke name, but it's for real sadcore. The idea where all the songs are sad, but the notion of like downbeat, kind of like very serious lyrical content is central to some of these ideas of slowness as well. Again, as I touched on a bit earlier on, the use of reverberation, you've got very slow beats, you've got, tend to have a lot more space, particularly kind of indie rock forms, to sort of like reverb effect, and touched again on that first presentation, which was great. Which does speed matter to and why? Well, musicians, they've got to play it, fans, they understand and interpret, maybe critics. But the key of, at the center of this is this notion of authenticity, which kind of permeates, I think, at most contextual understandings of popular music. What is real? What is true? What is honest? And there are so many others. As you know, authenticity is like a movable feast. It depends who you are, where you are, what period of time you're in, as to what is considered to be real and honest and true and authentic. There are arguments within genres and across genres about that. But the idea of like speed as a kind of like a signifier of authenticity, the faster you can play, the better you are. It kind of like, it's right from like bebop on, which I think has been a very important part of music. There's less emphasis on how good are you at playing slowly. So speed has tended to signify virtuosity and therefore as being good. But playing accurately at slow speeds, slow tempos, is very hard. Okay. Who's writing about tempo music? Psychologists are really interested in tempo music. They talk about the way in which listeners are aroused by different kind of tempos. Faster music creates more arousal. Consumer studies, academics, administrative research, they're trying to enable business to do things better. They look at music tempo and kind of retail customer behavior, how you can use the tempo of music to shape the retail experience. In other words, to get people to buy stuff more. Sports sciences academics write about tempo. and the way in which the speed of music, the tempo of music, can optimize physical training, like running, for example. There's surprisingly little about tempo outside of kind of straight musicology and those kind of fields. And kind of like popular music studies, there's stuff here and there, but it tends to be distributed across different discussions of the characteristics of music. So, the conventional argument about where slowcore comes from is that it was a reaction to grunge and the bands of Immersive of Seattle in the late 1980s in the Pacific Northwest, particularly the commercial breakthrough of Nirvana in 1991. That was interesting and problematic in lots of ways for the ideological constructions of what alternativeness was. So, we have a mainstream of notions of alternative rock. What goes along with that? You tend to have mainstreaming of the gender politics of the genre. We were kind of a huge fan base start to coalesce around grunge that didn't necessarily buy into the quote alternativeness of the ideological roots of the genre. So, it was part of a return in the early 90s, although none of the band, particularly Nirvana, would have wanted to think of themselves as being part of this. As a return to conventional, kind of, I got conventional twice, I'm like, I really mean it. Rock music. Really meant that word. Okay, so, there were slower indie bands that were around from kind of the late 80s onwards. One of my favorite bands of that year is Galaxy 500. From 87 to 91, but an emphasis on slow tempo and apparently quiet performance. I also saw Galaxy 500 back then, and they were extremely loud as well. So the notion of quietness is something that I don't really deal with in a lot. I don't deal with any kind of detail in this paper, but it's something I sort of want to look at. How can something that's quiet be loud? And is that important? A couple of examples of slowcore sounds. Number three of the top 10 slowcore albums is Bedhead from Texas.
Sound like indie rock.
Okay. Okay, I'll finish there. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. chair. Yeah. I know, but if you get any more theoretical than that, we'd love to find some sort of drop your line.
That'd be great. I mean, there's an example of like drum and bass, and you're really dancing drum and bass, where you've got like super skittery kind of like hi-hat patterns, but the bass is doing something much more slowly, so you dance to the bass line.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. And I just want to kind of point you to a sort of fantastic parody, I guess, of this whole movement by the wonderful Portlandian folk. And they've got a skit called Battle of the Gentle Bands, which, of course, you know, based in Portland, it ties in the whole hipster and the kind of slow food and the artisan beers and in a broad side stripe of the race to be more gentle and soft.
To be as sensitive as possible.
Yeah, that's right. Anyway, the person who wins the competition plays feathers lightly and the crowd goes wild.
Yeah, that's good. Thank you very much. I'll check this.
It was really interesting. I wanted to put a slightly musicological slant.
Thank you.
I wonder whether the concept of musical time might be useful in the sense that prison is the most classical area from Dr. Kramer and Jan Pastor and a few others, but it's sort of looking at that movement of time in a more metaphorical sense as the way it's shaped by structures and melodic lines and the combination of things and the sort of feeling that we get is with the music is moving quickly or dragging or going nowhere or something like that, and whether there's a distinction or a congruence between that kind of more aesthetic understanding, metaphorical understanding of speed when you listen to music versus what beat is and then the pulse of the tempo. Because those examples that you played, while they might be slow, they didn't feel like they were static in the same way as the same problem might be. Or equally, they didn't feel like a romantic analogy, which actually feels like it moves quite quickly, even at a slow tempo, because
yeah. Okay, yeah, that's great, though. That'd be very helpful, thank
you. I really enjoyed your paper. Kind of the opposite end of the spectrum. I thought I kind of knew what slowcore was, because I feel like back in this room, in the States, it's become kind of trendy with a lot of big rock bands lately. I don't know any fans. I bet like kids that are still seem like influenced by slowcore.
Yeah.
So I find that really interesting and cool how it's coming back, and I definitely want to check that out. When you're talking about slowness, at least in the bands that I listen to, but again more recent, what you said about shoegaze I find to be really accurate, since I think this is kind of like post-shoegaze. Well, there's a lot more emphasis on distortion and kind of like taking up space and like the slowness that's going on. And also, what I found to be like the most jarring part of slowness often was like the harmonic rhythm and how not only is it going very slowly, but like I feel like it takes a lot of confidence to be going that slowly and spend maybe like four bars in the same harmony, which is at first was one of the things I found most jarring about it. And I don't know if that applies to this slowness as well, but I think that's where a lot of power comes in, is like the confidence.
Yeah, that's great, because I tried covering Lowe's cover of Transmission as a bass player. It was excruciatingly hard to do because of that kind of BPM. So yeah, I mean, the people who play like that, that's a huge admiration for them.
Yeah. Excellent discussion. I think we have to move on, unfortunately, but I'm sure you will be around.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah.
Thank you again.
The University of Huddersfield, inspiring tomorrow's professionals.